At Song Bay, in late October 1967, a South Vietnamese Army battalion was attacked by the North Vietnamese 88th Regiment. The attackers were driven off with help from heavy American airstrikes. 2 days earlier, Loc Ninh, another provincial capital, had been stormed by the elite 273rd Regiment of the 9th Viet Cong Division, supported by the 65th Regiment of the NVA. Reinforcements from the South Vietnamese 5th Division and the American 1st fought for several days and shattered the NVA regiment, leaving over 850 NVA and NLF dead. The fiercest of all the border battles was near an American camp at Doc Tho in the Central Highlands, which had been massively reinforced following a tip-off from an NVA deserter. By November 1967, the 1st NVA Division, reinforced by two independent regiments, faced the American 4th Infantry Division, the 173rd Airborne Brigade, and a mechanized task force. Bloody battles would rage around Doc Tho for the whole month. Of all the desperate encounters of the Battle of Doc Tho, the most costly for both sides was the fight for Hill 875. In the highlands, whoever controlled the hills could rain down mortar and artillery fire on the valleys. The task of taking Hill 875 fell to two American battalions, one airborne and one from the 4th Infantry Division. Supporting them were fighters, B-52 bombers, and artillery, blasting the enemy defenses with high explosives and napalm. 170,000 artillery shells were fired on the enemy during this battle, and the fighter bombers flew 2,100 missions. The North Vietnamese defenders were so well dug in and so determined that the Americans were forced to launch repeated assaults, punctuated by yet more airstrikes, before they could reach the crest of the hill. It was a desperate and often nightmarish battle. It took a full week to capture Hill 875. The assaults cost more than 150 dead and 400 wounded, bringing American casualties at Doc Tho to almost 350, with just under 1,000 wounded. The North Vietnamese Army had lost 1,200 men. In December 1967, the dry season had just begun in the southern provinces. Every year, that was the signal for intense Viet Cong activity as the guerrillas moved troops and supplies into place for their next offensive. At the headquarters of Military Assistance Command Vietnam near Saigon, General Westmoreland and his senior officers ran a series of studies to try and predict where the enemy would strike in 1968. The enemy's Tet Offensive, though it had been predicted, took the U.S. command by surprise. They suspected that the Viet Cong would concentrate their efforts on the northern part of the country. The North Vietnamese Army might use up to 5 divisions to try and capture South Vietnam's 2 northernmost provinces. Other attacks in the highlands and near Saigon could provide the diversion. To counter the expected northern thrust, the Americans decided to send up their most mobile reaction force, the 1st Air Cavalry Division. In early January 1968, the division began the massive task of moving north together with other U.S. and South Vietnamese troops. By now, three-quarters of the American battalions in the south of Vietnam were deployed deep in the interior, near the Cambodian border. Unknown to them, elements of the NLF's 9th, 7th, and 5th Divisions, along with other units, were already heading towards the capital for the Tet Offensive. The Americans, suspicious of increased NLF radio traffic behind them and the lack of activity in the border areas, began a rapid redeployment back towards Saigon. American forces were pulled back from the border areas with astonishing speed. Such incredible mobility was something the Viet Cong had never expected. The ploy to use the battles on the borders to draw the Americans away from the real targets of the Tet Offensive had failed, although it had allowed NLF forces to get closer to Saigon. It was Lieutenant General Frederick Weyand, the commander of the U.S. 2nd Field Force, that had requested the American redeployment. Soon, more than half his battalions were again at bases close to Saigon. Nguyen ordered a series of sweeps to try and find the Viet Cong units that were surely somewhere within reach. The Americans were now convinced that a major offensive was coming soon. However, no one imagined that the Viet Cong were planning coordinated attacks across the whole country. Neither did anyone guess that they meant to break the traditional Tet New Year truce. As a precaution, the Americans did ask the South Vietnamese government to call off the truce and cancel army leave. But for political reasons, the request was refused. By the last week in January 1968, the Viet Cong had almost completed the massive task of deploying 84,000 guerrillas for the Tet Offensive. Most of the movement of troops and supplies had successfully been kept secret. Even villagers who didn't support the Viet Cong stayed neutral, and few reports of guerrilla activity reached the government's intelligence agencies. The traditional Viet Cong base areas around Saigon, districts like the Iron Triangle, played a vital part in the Viet Cong's preparations. Even the huge tunnel complex at Cu Chi, which the Americans had long believed had been completely destroyed, was still an important staging area and command center. Nearer the city, the growing crowds of travelers arriving for the Tet celebrations covered the infiltration of guerrillas and their weapons. As Tet drew closer, General Giap, the North Vietnamese commander and architect of the offensive, began to worry that his forces might not be in place on time. At dawn on January 21st, NVA troops attacked Khe Sanh village, where 200 Marines and South Vietnamese troops were stationed. The North Vietnamese attackers were a 400-man battalion of the 66th Regiment. The battalion attacked twice, but in the face of powerful American artillery and airstrikes, failed to take the village. An attempt at reinforcement by a South Vietnamese unit went disastrously wrong, and the whole force was destroyed. Later in the day, the village was evacuated and abandoned to the NVA. Later that evening, Khe San base itself was probed by a North Vietnamese assault unit. L Company of the 3rd Battalion drove off the attack. The following day, the base's western flank was reinforced by the newly arrived 1st Battalion of the 9th Marines, deployed at a quarry a mile from the perimeter. A platoon was detached from the battalion to occupy the nearby Hill 64. For the Marines inside the Khe San base, the days were now filled with feverish activity. There were sudden heavy bombardments from NVA guns and rockets. The massive damage done by the first barrage still had to be repaired. The biggest worry was ammunition. The first aircraft to land all carried shells. More than 130 tons were delivered in just 2 days. Reinforcements arrived too. The Marines were joined by 300 South Vietnamese Army Rangers, and Colonel Vound now had more than 6,000 men inside the compound and in 7 defended positions on the surrounding hills. While the Marines at Khe San braced themselves for the attack that was surely coming, General Westmoreland warned Washington that the battle could be the turning point of the whole war. In the United States, President Johnson was getting more and more worried about what might happen. The last thing he wanted was an American version of Dien Bien Phu, but he was determined to support his commander. Westmoreland would be allowed to fight the battle he wanted. There would be no U.S. withdrawal from Khe San, despite the fact that the NVA were still raining between 150 and 300 shells a day on Khe San. It was the awesome potential of American air power that convinced U.S. military leaders that Khe San could be defended. Before the battle had started, on 5th January, Westmoreland and U.S. tacticians devised a plan for defending Khe San by bombing. It was already being unleashed on the North Vietnamese divisions with devastating effect. The Americans called it Operation Niagara. The first part of Niagara was to pinpoint North Vietnamese troop concentrations. Information from air reconnaissance, special forces teams, radio interception, and every other possible source was fed into the intelligence system. Niagara also deployed the most advanced and secret surveillance technology in the world. Aircraft and helicopters scattered hundreds of electronic sensors across the enemy's main lines of approach. They could detect the movement of troops and send signals to alert the Americans. As the intelligence picture built up, Operation Niagara quickly gathered momentum. In spite of rivalry between the Air Force and the Marines over who should control operations, every available warplane in the area was standing by. At the peak of the siege, American planes dropped triple the tonnage of bombs delivered on a peak day during World War II. Added to this, fighter bombers would deliver 54,500 tons of napalm alone. Although fighter bombers were flying the vast majority of Niagara missions, most of the sheer weight of bombs was being delivered by B-52s as part of an ongoing operation codenamed Arclight. The strikes were flown around the clock. A cell of three B-52s arrived over the Khe San area every 90 minutes. The giant heavy bomber was able to carry a massive 27 tons of bombs. The aircraft dropped their loads from 30,000 feet, high enough so that the planes couldn't be seen or heard from the ground. The only warning most North Vietnamese troops got of a raid was the shattering detonation of the first bombs. Over the 77 days of the siege, B-52s flew over 2,500 sorties, dropping more than 53,000 tons of bombs. The biggest Arclight raid of the Vietnam War so far was launched as part of Operation Niagara on January 30th. American radio direction finding seemed to have discovered North Vietnamese Army headquarters for the Khe San offensive. Whether it was or not, no one would ever be sure, but the site was annihilated by two B-52 strikes in a single day. As it happened, dozens of attacks were launched a full day too soon. The North was still using the old calendar, which gave Tet as the 31st of January. In the South, the official New Year was the 30th of January. The wave of Viet Cong assaults in the early morning of January 30th, 1968, confirmed to the Americans that the suspected offensive was underway. General Westmoreland ordered all his forces to be on maximum alert. At the same time, the South Vietnamese Prime Minister, Nguyen Van Thieu, announced that the Tet truce was over and canceled the army's leave. 36 of the 44 provincial capitals were attacked, as were five of the nation's cities. The premature attacks should have been a disaster for General Giap's plan, but in fact they were a great success, and Giap still had at least some elements of tactical surprise. American attention remained fixed on the northern border, where Westmoreland expected the real offensive to come. There, the Marine combat base at Khe San had already been under siege for 10 days. The busiest time for the American guns was after dark, when the NVA were most active. Every night, the Marines laid down concentrated patterns of fire on likely areas. Sometimes, in bombardments known as mini arclights, an intense artillery barrage was combined with radar-guided airstrikes to saturate a target completely. As for the North Vietnamese artillery, most of the guns, rockets, and mortars were by now in place. Getting them into position had been a massive job. Northern troops had also sighted hundreds of ammunition dumps around Khe San and across the border in Laos. The North Vietnamese had placed large numbers of their shorter-range guns and mortars within 2 miles of the Khe San base. Most of the big rockets were fired from Hill 881 North. The heavy guns were much further away, on Hill 305, and in caves on the slopes of the Koh Rock Mountain across the border in Laos. While they could hit the Americans, the Marine guns didn't have the range to hit back. Even the Army's big guns on the rock pile and Camp Carroll couldn't reach the NVA's heavy batteries. By now, more than 2 weeks into the battle, over 150 North Vietnamese artillery rounds were hitting the Khe San base and its outposts every day, rising to a peak on February 23rd of 1,300. For the Marines, building the best possible protection was a matter of life and death. Orders were that every man had to have access to a bunker able to stop an 82-millimeter mortar round. Command posts were to withstand a 120-millimeter hit. As for the heavy shells of the NVA's biggest guns, nothing could stop those. The North Vietnamese artillery hitting Khe San and the Marine outposts was all indirect fire. Spotters on the hills corrected the gunner's aim by radio, but the gunners themselves could never see the targets. What NVA commanders wanted most of all was to place guns on the hills overlooking the base. From there, they could pour devastating fire straight down onto the Americans. On February 5th, 1968, the American chain of electronic sensors detected a large-scale NVA movement. The activity seemed to point to an imminent attack on Hill 881 South. The U.S. reaction was a massive Niagara raid. Whole North Vietnamese units were caught in the open as the entire area around the hill was devastated in a massive storm of bombs. Although a North Vietnamese attack on Hill 881 South had been blocked, the Americans had failed to detect a battalion closing on an outpost called 861A. There, a single Marine company drove off two determined assaults as artillery fire destroyed the follow-on waves of NVA troops. On the night of February 6th, the North Vietnamese 304th Division began to clear ground approaches to Khe San from the west. The first objective was the American Special Forces camp at Lang Ve, manned by a handful of U.S. troops and a battalion of South Vietnamese local militia. The attack was launched by the 66th Regiment, 1,500 men backed for the first time by tanks. In less than 3 hours, the Longwei camp was overrun, and only 74 of the 400 U.S. and South Vietnamese defenders survived. The next target for the NVA was Hill 64, occupied by a single American platoon. A two-pronged infantry attack was launched against the hill, but a relief platoon, supported by fierce air and artillery fire, drove the North Vietnamese to the west. There, they were again hammered by a massive American bombardment. Even though the NVA had again failed to take any more American hill outposts and had lost hundreds of men in the attempt, they had at least captured Longwei. A thorn in their side had been eliminated, and they had cleared Route 9 for their own use. Artillery reinforcements, including 130-millimeter guns, could now be brought much closer to the Khe San base. The Americans were sure the NVA had finished building up their forces at Khe San and were ready for the main attack. But to their surprise, the expected assault still didn't come. Instead, the siege settled down to a deadly daily duel fought by artillery and aircraft. At the same time, the North Vietnamese began to launch frequent small-scale probes against the base perimeter. In Washington, anxiety about the fate of the Marines at Khe San was mounting. A relief operation was being planned, but it would demand powerful forces and couldn't be mounted for weeks. The weather was still too poor. Meantime, if the base's air bridge was cut, it would be all over for Khe San. The troops manning the base needed ammunition, food, and medicines. In 1968, appalling weather with ground fog and low cloud stopped all low-altitude deliveries. The only option was to parachute supplies into a drop zone just outside the perimeter. Several thousand tons would arrive this way, but still, for the Marines, bad weather invariably meant tight rations. Although the battle to supply the main base was being won, the hill outposts were a much bigger problem. A fifth of Khe San's manpower was stationed on the hills. The men were suffering almost 50% casualties, and the posts depended completely on helicopters for supply. The tactics the Americans devised depended on swamping the enemy anti-aircraft guns and mortars around a landing zone with a high-speed assault. 12 Skyhawk fighter bombers, 4 Huey gunships, up to 16 supply helicopters, and an airborne command and control aircraft all acted together. The first stage was for 4 Skyhawks to hit North Vietnamese positions with bombs and napalm. 2 more laid tear gas. Next, 2 Skyhawks dropped smoke bombs to create a corridor, and 30 seconds later, the transport helicopters swooped in, covered by the Huey gunships. Meanwhile, four more Skyhawks with rockets, bombs, and guns made close-in attacks. The whole operation was over in less than 5 minutes. The new tactics quickly earned the title Super Gaggle, because the helicopters looked like an oversized flock of geese. With the fighters and gunships in the air too, the method took incredible timing to pull off successfully. But it worked. Only two more helicopters would be shot down, supplying the hill outposts. By now, the strain of the long siege was beginning to tell on the troops at Khe San. Being under shellfire every day meant a steady drain of casualties and constant tension. On the base perimeter, the watchword was constant vigilance. The North Vietnamese were probing the defenses with infantry and sapper teams. The Americans were facing assaults of up to 200 men at a time as the enemy tested for weaknesses in the line. The Marines were also plagued by hidden machine gun nests, which could open up at any moment, day or night. Half the South Vietnamese Army's troops were still away from their units on leave. Even in the capital Saigon, the Viet Cong's most important objective, government forces were scattered and under strength. The Viet Cong plan for the attacks inside Saigon had been worked out to the last detail. Most of the assaults were to be carried out by units of C-10. The Independence Palace, the offices of the South Vietnamese president, would be hit first. Next on the list was the Joint General Staff headquarters of the South Vietnamese Army, near to the Americans' main headquarters in Vietnam. Tan Sanut Air Base was to be seized, along with the South Vietnamese Navy headquarters and the American Embassy, the main symbol of U.S. power in Vietnam. The government radio station would also be occupied. After the initial assaults by C-10, the main Viet Cong battalions were to sweep into the city from all sides to support the offensive. In the early morning of January 31st, 1968, Viet Cong units the length and breadth of South Vietnam surged into action.
Hey, I hope they're just fucking with us. I ain't ready for this shit.
Amen. Oriental New Year, and it's a new war. The Viet Cong simultaneously attacked just about every major city and town in South Vietnam. In one day, they increased the scope of the war dramatically. Howard Tuckner was there.
The war came to Saigon early in the morning of January 31st. The first target was the symbol of the American presence in Vietnam, the United States Embassy. About 20 Viet Cong had invaded the embassy compound and were now battling American Marines and military police. The Viet Cong had penetrated to the center of what was supposed to be the most secure city in Vietnam.
Not knowing where they are, that's the worst thing. Riding around and running the sewers and the gutters anywhere, be anywhere. Just hope you can stay alive day to day. Everybody just wants to go back home and go to school. That's about it.
You lost any friends?
Quite a few. We lost one the other day. The whole thing stinks, really.
Awful sick of it. I'll be so glad to go home. I don't know. It's the worst area we've been in since I've been in Vietnam.
You think it's worth it?
Yeah, I don't know. They say we're fighting for something. I don't know.
In Saigon, as one attack after another had erupted, there was complete confusion. Neither the South Vietnamese Army nor the Americans had a plan to deal with anything like this. The Army's units were under strength and scattered, while the American MPs of the 716th Battalion had been left out of the alert issued the day before. Only 300 military police were on duty. Of the many attacks the Viet Cong unleashed in Saigon on the morning of January 31st, the assault on the government radio station was the best organized. The station was captured, and the plan was to broadcast a tape of Ho Chi Minh calling for the population to rise up against the government. Ho's message never was broadcast. The station's electricity was cut off by the army in the first minutes of the attack. After a fierce six-hour battle, government soldiers, including paratroopers brought in from the airport, succeeded in forcing out the surviving Viet Cong. Barely a mile away, at the Independence Palace and the nearby Navy headquarters, the Viet Cong attackers had been driven away from their main targets within minutes. The sapper team had been forced to hole up in a nearby building. The fight lasted more than 15 hours. In the end, nearly all the Viet Cong inside were killed. Although U.S. military police were involved in firefights all over the city, in fact, very few American installations had been targeted in Saigon. The exception was the American Embassy, the ultimate symbol of U.S. support for South Vietnam. The assault on the American embassy began at 2:30 a.m. on January 31st. 15 Sapper commandos blew a hole in the wall of the compound and charged through the breach. The fighters had killed 4 American military police guards and a Marine, but their own officers had been killed almost at once. The sappers took cover and waited for reinforcements. Soon, the Viet Cong were trapped within the compound, under fire from all sides. The fight for the compound lasted for 6 hours, but the effects of the battle would last much longer. All around the world, an abiding image had been created, that of American troops battling to recapture their own embassy in the very heart of Saigon. The Viet Cong attack on the American embassy and most other targets in Saigon city center had been launched by the elite sapper commandos of the C-10 battalion. The plan was that a follow-up force of 4,000 would arrive quickly. But time and time again, the main battalions had been bogged down in firefights and house-to-house battles. One of the sharpest clashes yet had happened near an American officer's quarters. The battle had quickly drawn in military police and any other U.S. personnel that could grab a weapon. During the night, a truck carrying 25 American military policemen to the fight was hit by a VC rocket head-on, and subsequent machine gun fire killed 16 Americans in a narrow street. Relief attempts had developed into a furious engagement which would go on for 12 hours. Only a few miles away, Tan Son Nhut Air Base was one of the most important centers of American power in Vietnam. The defenders of Tan Son Nhut were a squadron of U.S. Air Force police, 2 platoons of Army Headquarters Guards, and the only 2 companies of South Vietnamese Army airborne troops not yet committed to battle elsewhere in the city. On the perimeter of Tan Son Nhut, the Viet Cong had seized several key buildings as springboards for their main assault and attacked the compound containing the villas of senior officers of the South Vietnamese General Staff. The guerrillas meant to hit the base from 3 sides with more than 1,000 troops. A large textiles plant was occupied as the base for their heavy machine guns and rockets. Only the arrival of an armored reconnaissance unit of the 25th Infantry Division that had raced to the scene from its base 15 miles away saved Tan Son Nhut. The tanks and APCs hit the attackers from behind, and in furious fighting had split the Viet Cong force. In the hours that followed, the guerrillas were hammered by American helicopter gunships and fighter bombers. The attack on Tansanut was soon completely broken. Fifteen miles north of Saigon was the massive American logistical complex at Long Bien. Nearby was the U.S. base at Ben Hoa, and between them, the headquarters of 2nd Field Force and 3 Corps, from which the American and South Vietnamese battles in the Saigon area were being coordinated. The main attacking forces were two full regiments of the Viet Cong 5th Division. After a heavy rocket and mortar barrage, the 275th assaulted Long Bien from the north side, while a local force battalion mounted a diversionary raid and sappers blew up part of a massive ammunition dump outside the main complex. At the same time, the 274th hit Ben Hoa and a local battalion tried to seize 3 Corps headquarters. The American 199th Light Infantry Brigade, defending Long Bien, was attacked by a mechanized reserve which hit the flank of the Viet Cong attacking Ben Hoa. A unit of the 101st Airborne Division was airlifted in while helicopter gunships and more mechanized units joined the day-long battle, eventually driving the Viet Cong away from all their objectives. For American commanders faced with the huge scale of the Viet Cong assault in and around Saigon, Tet had been an extraordinary test of nerve. It had seemed as if the enemy was everywhere at once. Throughout the day, General Weyand had been directing the American battle, even as his own headquarters at Long Bien was under attack. In the first 2 hours of the Tet Offensive, Weyand had deployed 5,000 airborne and armored reinforcements. More than 500 armored personnel carriers, mounting their deadly 50 caliber machine guns, had been sent into combat. So far, all the main Viet Cong assaults had been at least contained. But no one doubted there was still hard fighting ahead.
How would you assess the enemy's purposes yesterday and today?
The enemy, very deceitfully, has taken advantage of the Tet Truce in order to create maximum consternation within South Vietnam, particularly in the populated areas. In my opinion, this is...
In spite of the temptation to throw everything he had into the battle against the guerrillas, General Westmoreland was determined to hold back. He was still convinced that the Tet attacks were a diversion from the main effort, which he expected to come in the northern border areas. He was deeply reluctant to commit his most mobile forces to street battles. By now, Westmoreland knew that the Viet Cong attacks were being countered successfully all over the country, but at a great cost to American lives. The South Vietnamese Army was standing up well. The next stage would be to defeat the guerrillas town by town and battalion by battalion. In the far south of Vietnam, in the heavily populated Mekong Delta, the Tet Offensive had seen Viet Cong assaults on nearly all of the 16 provincial capitals. Khon Tho, the South Vietnamese Army's Four Corps headquarters, was also hit. Route 4 was cut in 62 places. In the central and northern provinces, 11 cities, towns, and bases, including two corps headquarters, had been attacked in the premature offensive of January 30th. Eight more had been hit the following night. All the major attacks would be repulsed within a week, except in one city. The assault on the old Vietnamese imperial capital of Hue would lead to the biggest and bloodiest battle of the whole Tet Offensive. The city of Hue was the third largest in South Vietnam and the ancient capital of its former emperors. It was split in two by the perfumed river, over which ran key rail and road bridges. On the north side of the river was the citadel, a walled city within the city, surrounded by a maze of streets and originally the home of the emperor. Near the citadel was the headquarters of the 1st South Vietnamese Army Division. On the other side of the river was the American headquarters compound. The only South Vietnamese unit inside Hue was the elite Black Panther Reconnaissance Company. The assault on Hue was launched by two local Viet Cong battalions, elements of the 6th Regiment of the 325th NVA Division, and the 4th Independent Regiment. Within 24 hours, Hue fell to 5,000 NVA troops, who were quickly reinforced by a further 7,000. They instantly raised the North Vietnamese flag over the citadel. Thousands of NVA troops ranged through the streets, mopping up pockets of resistance, and most of Hue was quickly secured. The exceptions were small areas around the American and South Vietnamese headquarters. There, the defenders held out and had been reinforced by small units rushed in from outside the city. The U.S. Marines and South Vietnamese troops that had come to the aid of their beleaguered headquarters had run a gauntlet of NVA forces to get into the city. Bigger units were battling to follow them, but it would be days before they would get inside Hue in any strength. Meantime, it was clear that the North Vietnamese Army meant to remain and would not be dislodged without a major battle.
Doc, where's the sniper?